Hi, my name is Peter Bybee. I'm the president and CEO of Security On Demand, and I'm here today with Stephen Bay. Stephen is the director of the Threat Recon Unit at Security On Demand. Welcome, Stephen.
Thank you.
First of all, why don't you tell us a little bit about your background?
Sure. So I started out my career at the National Security Agency through the Air Force as a Persian Farsi linguist. After my time at the Air Force, I spent a few years at NSA working as a cyber intelligence analyst. And after my time at NSA, I evolved into commercial cybersecurity. And that's what I do now, is managing cybersecurity.
Great. Well, one of the things that we would love to hear about in particular is a very interesting story about your worst day in cybersecurity. Tell us a little bit about how that came about, and in particular, maybe you could go into a little bit about the cover story from a particular individual.
Sure.
and how that came about.
Sure. So the reason we're here and the message that we're sharing is trying to help people learn lessons about how they can prepare for the worst day of their career, right? It's inevitable we're all going to have that day in our career that's just going to be, well, awful. And for me, that worst day came the day that Edward Snowden revealed himself to the world as being the leaker behind the NSA leaks that had hit the media a few days before. I had the unfortunate distinction of being Edward Snowden's boss and manager. And so I was intimately involved in the hunt and the aftermath of everything that happened with Snowden. And you know, you talked about kind of the leading up to what happened with Snowden. I actually hired Snowden only about a month and a half before he fled the country. And from the beginning, he started laying the groundwork for what his exit strategy would be and for being able to steal data and information. He came to me about a week after starting with me and informed me that he had epilepsy. And he used the epilepsy as an excuse for medical appointments and all that to be able to be late for work, to stay late after hours when most people weren't in, so he could download data, as well as it led to him being as his exit strategy and being able to leave the country. And so shortly, you know, about mid to late May of 2013, I actually hired Snowden on the 1st of April 2013, middle of late May. He informed me that the epilepsy was getting unmanageable. There are things that he couldn't handle. He couldn't function very well. And it was getting so bad that he was going to have to go through 2 days of medical tests that next week. And he said, if they go bad, I'm going to have to take time off work. Well, sure enough, after those 2 days, Monday and Tuesday, he emailed me and said, hey, I got done with the doctors. The results came back. The tests went really bad. I'm not going to be able to work for a while. And as his manager, I obviously offered my support. You know, it was unfortunate having an employee that was doing good work and also knew have those circumstances. But offered him my support and said, get in touch with HR. Let's get short-term disability going, and we'll take care of you.
So unbeknownst to you, this was a carefully constructed cover story.
Yeah.
For that was already, you know, in motion, that he had actually, you know, calculated ahead of time.
Yeah, it's clear now, looking back, that this is all planned, it's all calculated. He doesn't have epilepsy or any medical issue. In fact, when he emailed me that final communication that we had, he was already in Hong Kong. He had actually left for Hong Kong a couple of days before that and was kind of tying up the loose ends of his exit strategy.
So he disappeared. You couldn't get a hold of him for some period of time. And then, you know, what happened next? People started looking for him.
Right.
Tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah. So it was, as I said, it was middle of May, and at the end of May, timesheets were due. And so we had a lot of administrative things you have to go through when you're dealing with people on medical leave or sick leave and those sorts of things. And so he wasn't responding to any phone calls or text messages. And I contacted my boss as the end of the pay period was coming and said, hey, Ed's not responding to anything. I'm worried about him. I'm worried he's dead somewhere. I'm not sure what's going on. And so he contacted NSA security and informed them based on defined protocols, and that, hey, we've got a guy missing, and he's on medical leave, but he's not responding to anything. Mm-hmm. And so that was on a Friday. That next week, I got a call from NSA Hawaii security, because we're out there in Hawaii. And I'd known them pretty well, worked with them quite a bit with onboarding people and such. And they said, hey, we know you got a guy missing. We hear he's on medical leave. We don't normally get involved in medical issues, but you know, we're a close-knit family here in Hawaii, and so we want to help you look for him. And so we spent the rest of that week looking for him. I went by his house, drove by his girlfriend's place, tried to call his parents, couldn't hear anything at all. So.
And at what point did it start getting serious? Like, you know, he was sort of missing, but right. then, you know, at some point, you found out that he was actually in Hong Kong and had fled the country.
Right.
Tell us what, how did that revelation come about?
Right. So the middle of that week looking for him, that's when the first leaks hit the news, right? Mm. The Guardian article hit, and then Washington Post published an article. And that really threw those of us at the NSA through a loop. It was, you know, I was an Intel analyst and a senior guy, but it wasn't anything in level of importance, but it still affected all of us at the lower levels as well.
Right.
But it never crossed my mind that he was the guy leaking this stuff. In fact, the day before he revealed himself, it was a Saturday, I was hanging out with my best friend, and we also were best friends, we worked together, our desks touched, and I was telling about my crazy week looking for Ed, or for Snowden, and he said, wouldn't it be crazy if Ed were the guy leaking all this stuff? And I laughed out loud. I didn't think that was a remote possibility at all. And in fact, I said, you know, there's no way on earth Ed would be the guy doing that. But if he did, that would be my absolute worst nightmare.
Well, as it turned out, after, you know, you obviously discovered, or it was revealed to you, that he was the leaker.
Right.
I just can't imagine what was going on. That was undoubtedly your worst day. It wasn't even a day that you were at work. It was like a Sunday,
that
right?
That was Sunday, that's right.
So what happened after that, once you found out?
So that Sunday morning, I was in some meetings, and I had my phone turned off, and so apparently that's when everything dropped. And the meetings ended, and I pulled out my phone and turned it on, and my phone had exploded with missed text messages and mixed phone calls. And it just so happened, coincidentally, that first text message that I saw was from that friend of mine, who simply said, sorry, man, looks like your worst nightmare came true. And I knew exactly what he meant. And I did a quick search, and I saw Snowden's name all over the media, and I saw his picture on the news. And so I went in and found an empty room in the church, and I melted down. And I lost it. You know, every irrational thought, feeling one can have in that period of crisis fell on my shoulders, ranging from me, I'm going to be blamed, I'm going to lose my family, I'm going to go to jail, my employees are going to get fired, not to mention the national security implications that may come as a result of all these data leaks.
Right.
So once I got my composure, I went home, and I pulled my wife to the side and where we could have a little privacy, and I couldn't even speak. I was in such shock. And I cried on her shoulder and just said, it's him, over and over.
Yeah.
And so, but I got my composure as the day went on, and ended up, you know, my first priority was to take care of my people, make sure they're okay. I had about 15 employees at the time. And I called all of them, and I talked through it with them, and just listened to them. And, you know, they were as panicked as I was. Even some of them didn't know him very well. Mm-hmm. But I tried to make them a priority. I just visited with on phone over with all of my leadership, my company, and other folks like that. And it was later that day I got that call, as I knew it was coming, from NSA Security saying, hey, we want to meet you down at FBI offices.
Well, I can only imagine what it's like when the FBI calls you up and says, Stephen, we'd like to interview you. Yeah. What was going through your mind at the time when you got the call? I'm sure that must have been pretty scary.
Yeah, it was. You know, it didn't re-cause all those same irrational thoughts, but a lot of that stress and fear. You know, I'd seen all the movies, all the TV shows, right?
Sure.
And so I was driving down to Kapolei, where the FBI offices were, and picturing this, you know, bright light, heat lamp shining on me in a dark room, and I was going to get grilled by these tough and mean interrogators. And fortunately, it wasn't like that at all. You know, I got into the office, and there were both FBI agents there as well as NSA security agents. And we had a conversation, and they wanted to know everything I knew about Snowden. They wanted to know, you know, how did I hire him? What did the interview process go like? What kind of person was he? Was there any discussions on privacy and the Fourth Amendment and all these things that he was using as a stated motivation for doing what he did? Any discontent with the agency and its processes? And so, you know, we kind of went through all of that and the whole life cycle of the time I met him 5 months earlier to that point in time. Mm-hmm. So yeah, it was stressful. But you know, the FBI handled it really well, and they were professional about it.
That's great. It's good to hear that they were very professional in their approach. So what happened when you went into work the next day? I'm sure that was probably not something you were looking forward to, but by then the news had spread, everybody knew about it, and you walked in the next morning, and what happened then?
So I almost dreaded the next day more than I did like driving down to FBI. Different feelings, but man, was it gonna be awkward. And sure enough, I went into the office, and we didn't support the same mission. We had different leadership, government leadership that were over us. And I went in to met up with, he supported NTOC, which is a known cyber organization, NSA, and I went up to the NTOC Hawaii leadership after dropping off my bags, first people I talked to, and I owned it. You know, I kind of took the approach that nobody likes a whiner, nobody likes a victim. I didn't want to go in there with my hands up, hey, it's not me, or anything like that. I went in, and I apologized, and took ownership of it, and you know, how can we help to fix things? And yeah, they were angry, they were upset, as well they should be, but we had very constructive conversations. I ended up meeting with the director of NSA Hawaii as well. He made a great quote, great comment, where he said, you really got caught holding the hot potato when time ran out, because he'd been planning this for a long time. So overall, Snowden had been planning it for a long time. So overall, it was uncomfortable, it was awkward, and it was crisis, but we handled it the best we could.
Well, I'm sure you've had a little bit of time to reflect back on, you know, what could you have done better, if you'd have known then what you know now, right. I'm sure you probably would have done a few things differently. What were some of the lessons learned as you look back?
Yeah, you know, as you said, there's a lot of things that you can look back on and evaluate and try to figure out. You know, how could I have done things differently? And looking back, there were no real major red flags. There's nothing I can look back on and say I should have known better. Certainly nothing that would lead me to think that one of my employees was going to steal NSA data and flee the country. Right. But there are really three themes that I took away as lessons learned that I think all of us, when we hit that day of crisis, that we can apply to how we move forward and how we handle the crisis. So the first one of those really ties around preparation. So we all know crisis is coming, right? We all understand that that we're going to have that day, that worst day in our life. What makes the difference is how you respond to it and how you prepare. So whether it's a cyber breach or insider threat like I had or any other number of crises, it's really incumbent on organizations, probably working through risk management, to define what are the likely crises that we're going to have, what's the likelihood of those occurring, what impact will those have, and then prioritize in that way, and then putting together a strategy on how you're going to respond for each contingency, and actually really war game those things.
Right.
So that's really the first one is putting in the time for preparation. If you prepare right, right, in any crisis you have these sub-crises that are static and planned, and things you can predict will occur. But there's always things you can't predict. So if you've practiced, you've war-gamed, you've prepared, your brain can focus less on the stuff you need to, the planned stuff, and more on the dynamic crises that occur when things like that happen. The second lesson really ties down to a personal element, right? We should all have our own code of values and our own ethics. And I think as we've observed various companies through data breaches or other crises, it's very easy in time of crisis to lose your ethical compass and lose your way. And in those circumstances, it can cause a lot of problems by doing unethical things, both put you at risk as an individual and put your company at risk. So holding on to your code of ethics, having those defined and well established within you ahead of time can help you navigate this this abnormal, anomalous event in your life. And then finally, it comes down to security controls and administrative controls. Now, there's nothing we really could have done to have prevented Snowden, right? He had an agenda, he was gonna do what he was gonna do. Right. But there are things that could have been done to help detect it, right? And whether it's a security breach, like a cyber attack, or any other number of crises, especially on the cyber area, applying technological controls, whether it's security monitoring and detection, identity and access management, things like that can be done, and just having a technological strategy for detecting and protecting and those sorts of things. But even more so, if you take Snowden as an insider threat, which is he's kind of the quintessential insider threat, right. We have to stop thinking of the insider threat as a cybersecurity domain. It's really not. It's an HR domain. It's an HR issue. It involves people, and insiders are broader than that.
Right.
And so we really want to focus on the HR element of it as well, and implementing it both administrative and security controls to help protect us.
Do you think that, you know, again, knowing what you know now, that there would have been a way to detect, I mean, Snowden had been planning this attack for some time.
Right.
Do you think they're you know, applying it in terms of future lessons learned, do you think that there's anything that organizations can do today to maybe not just prepare, but maybe anticipate? What are some of the things that we should be looking for, you know, that might be these carefully planned insider attacks?
Right, so if we look at insiders, right, the kind of profile of an insider is they've got an agenda. Mm-hmm. They often change behaviors.
I mean, agenda like a social agenda or
they
something.
They have something driving them to do what they're going to do.
Right.
Snowden's stated agenda or purpose was the privacy, alleged abuses by the NSA. But others, it could be money, it could be espionage, any number of things.
Now, does that mean like monitoring like social media and that sort of thing?
It could be. I don't know the role of a company, but at least internally, monitoring your activities, and looking for anomalies, identifying when people try to get access to things they shouldn't have access to, those sorts of things.
So as we look out into the sort of the future, and if we were to look into the crystal ball, so to speak, do you anticipate more insider threats coming towards us,
you know,
in the industry?
I don't think you'll ever be free of insider threats. You'll never be completely free of cyber attacks or any other number of things like that. It's something that, you know, it's a war on insider threat. It can't necessarily be won, but there are things you can do to mitigate and lessen the likelihood or lessen the impact. But people who have an agenda are going to have an agenda, and they're going to try to execute it. Mm-hmm. But again, like we've talked about, there are lessons we can apply, there's preparation we can do, and there's controls we can put in place to help mitigate that risk and lessen the impact it is on our organization.
Right. So I think that as a professional, maybe not everybody thinks about maybe having their worst day, but is there anything in the moment of crisis that you would maybe do differently? You know, you talked a lot about preparation earlier. Is there anything as the crisis is unfolding that, again, looking back, you wished you either would have done or could have done better?
Yeah, I think for me, I had never mentally prepared for a crisis in my career. Everything had always been hunky-dory. So I never really took the time to sit down. How am I going to handle certain things?
Yeah.
So looking back, what I wish I would have done is just accepted that crisis was going to occur, something would happen. I never thought it would happen at this scale, right? You can't really predict that. But I know that NSA, for instance, knows that these things are going to occur. They were well prepared, and they may not have liked it. A lot of damage occurred to them. But these are things that they know about, right? I wasn't prepared like that. So for me, I could have used a little bit more of personal planning and preparation so that when that day of crisis hit, it may have been a little bit of less of a shock to my system.
Yeah. Well, certainly I've observed that even when you do plan on the day and you have a plan, sometimes the plan doesn't always go according to action, and sometimes people don't even remember the plan, much less follow the plan.
That's
so
the truth.
Certainly there's a lot of lessons learned. Well, Stephen, I'd like to thank you for your time today and appreciate the opportunity here to share a few thoughts about cybersecurity on RSA Conference TV. And again, thanks for watching us today.